I make videos about walkable cities and urban mobility. I mostly talk about great cities in Europe, so as you'd expect, I get a lot of excuses and cope, especially from North Americans. Now, I'm not particularly interested in making debunking videos. I'd rather show you examples of great cities and let my experiences speak for themselves. But there's one lame excuse that is so common, so prevalent, so ubiquitous, that I want to talk about it. And that's the excuse that my country is too big to have trains, bicycle infrastructure, walkable neighborhoods, or whatever. This is an excellent and well-thought-out explanation as to why North American cities are so terrible. Well, that is, until you think about it for more than about 12 seconds. Most people are ignorant about urban planning and urban mobility. I certainly was until about a decade ago, and that's understandable. I mean, why would you know about these things, right? But Americans are uniquely ignorant because American cities are very poorly designed, and their insular culture and limited international travel opportunities means that most Americans have never even seen a well-designed city. Though, to be fair, Canadians and Australians aren't very far behind. So when someone new to walkable cities sees an example of a great city and they realize it's clearly better than where they live, their first gut reaction is to grab any difference between the two and make that the reason as to why their city can't be the same. Sometimes it's the weather, Canadians love that one. Sometimes it's culture, sometimes it's population, sometimes it's a misunderstanding of history. But usually, it's that European country is small, my country is big, this video is stupid, and you're an idiot, or something along those lines. My personal favorite, though, is the Wikipedia contrarian, that guy who looks up the size of the Netherlands on Google or Wikipedia, and then pastes that number into their comment like it's some kind of epic own. And I can tell which source they use because Wikipedia and Google have different numbers. In case you're curious, here's how big the Netherlands is compared to the United States, Canada, and Australia. So why is this argument so stupid? Well, quite simply, Americans aren't traveling from Fluffy Landing to Hump Tulips every day. Canadians aren't traveling from Dildo to Spuzzum every day. And Australians aren't traveling from Chinaman's Knob to Useless Loop every day. And also, why are there two places in Australia called Chinaman's Knob? Alright, you know what? I am done talking about Australia. People do not travel across their country on a regular basis. They travel within their city. So the only thing that really matters to most people is the design of that city. Which is what we're talking about here. For example, in the United States, over 45% of trips, all trips, are 3 miles or less. That's 5 kilometers for the rest of my audience. These are distances that could be easily done by walking or cycling. So, despite the size of the country and the sprawliness of the cities, Americans don't actually travel that far for most trips. But unsurprisingly, almost all of those trips are taken by car because it's too dangerous to walk or cycle and public transportation is non-existent, which again, is the whole point. This may come as a surprise to some people because Americans are obsessed with commuting and the average commute length in the US is about 20 miles. That's 32 kilometers for everyone else. But there are many more trips that people take on a daily basis that are not commuting. Even here in the Netherlands, there are many places, especially smaller towns and villages, where people commute to work by car. But do all of their other trips, such as grocery shopping, visiting friends, or going to appointments, by walking, cycling, or public transit. They have those options available to them for shorter trips, which again, is the point. The problem is not cars, it's car dependency. We need to give people the freedom to not to have to drive. Though regardless, 32 kilometers is still a perfectly reasonable distance to commute by train, if those trains existed. And now, this is where Americans will claim that America is too big for trains, which is absolutely comical because America was literally built by the railroads, and so was Canada for that matter. In the 1800s, a railroad company would buy up all the land west of wherever they were, build a railroad and a bunch of stations, and then sell the land near those stations, made valuable by the rail line, to recoup their investment. Nearly every town, city, and village in the United States and Canada had a train station and was connected by rail, with very few exceptions. And almost every city and town had a streetcar line too, with very few exceptions. And every one of those places was built to be walkable, as every one of those places was built before automobiles were common, again, with very few exceptions. 100 years ago, you could get a train from almost any city to just about any other city on the continent, and even many towns and villages too. The reason those train stations don't exist anymore is because they were bulldozed, often to make room for highways, along with the walkable downtowns they were connected to. American cities were not built for the car, they were bulldozed for the car. But even if North America wasn't built on trains, and to be clear, it was, the size of the country would still be irrelevant, because most intercity travel is still regional. There are dozens of city pairs in the US that are the perfect population and distance for high-speed rail or high-frequency rail, and City Nerd has made a video about this if you'd like more details. As for Canada, it may be a huge country, but about 50% of the entire population lives in this little area, which is literally in a line. And this is Japan to scale, the country famous for all its trains. So yes, Canada, you can build a high-speed train between Toronto and Montreal. And by the way, here's China with its high-speed rail map. I always laugh when some ignorant commenter tells me, "You obviously have no idea how big the US is," but actually, yes, I know exactly how big it is. Because I've driven across the continent 8 times. I know that you can travel long distances in America without encountering any borders, but did you know that you can do that in Europe too? This is the Schengen zone, a group of European countries that allows visa-free travel. That means I can drive to any one of these places and never encounter a border at all. Yes, I know I can't drive to Iceland. But the Schengen zone is not constant, and new countries are being added every few years. For example, Croatia was just added in 2023. And Bulgaria, Romania, Cyprus, and Montenegro plan to join in the near future. But if that happens, will Amsterdam need to tear up all their bike lanes because the Schengen zone is too big? No, of course not. That would be stupid, which is the same reason why saying America is too big for bike lanes is also stupid. The fact is, it is possible to build walkable neighborhoods everywhere. They have existed in every country on Earth for thousands of years. And it is possible to connect those walkable places together by high-quality public transportation, to make it so that people can go from any walkable area to any other walkable area, regardless of the size of the city, the country, or the continent. That's how I can bike to the station in Amsterdam, get on a high-speed train to Berlin, transfer to the U-Bahn, and walk to my hotel. But even if size did matter, then why isn't Maryland covered in bike lanes and train tracks, or Hawaii, or Prince Edward Island? Instead, pretty much everywhere in the US and Canada looks exactly like this, regardless of where it is or what size it is. So, why do American cities suck so much then? Well, there are lots of reasons, as I've talked about in many, many previous videos, but I think the most important one to talk about here is bad land use. US and Canadian cities waste land. They use huge amounts of land for single-family housing, surface parking lots, low-density developments, and excessively wide roads. When you travel around any North American city, you'll see empty lots like this all over the place. There's no acknowledgement that good land is valuable, that it can be used for more efficient purposes. If the local strip mall goes out of business, it isn't turned into something more useful, it's just left there to rot, and a new big box store is built farther down the road. This makes everything too spread out to walk and too inefficient for public transportation, and it's usually too dangerous to cycle because of all the cars. This is ultimately the root of a lot of the problems that I talk about on this channel. In particular, I made the video linked here in the top right about how this explains why public transportation is so bad in North America. Now, you could argue that a bigger country lets you be lazier with land use, but on the flip side, the Netherlands doesn't have good land use because it's small. It has good land use because there were policies and regulations put in place to use land efficiently in order to protect good quality arable farmland, which is one of the reasons why the Netherlands is the world's second largest exporter of agricultural products by value. This wasn't an inevitability, and there are lots and lots of smaller countries in the world that don't do this right. The United States destroys over 750,000 acres of natural and agricultural lands every year to build sprawling suburbs. And Ontario, Canada, where I'm from, destroys 175 acres of farmland per day to build more car-dependent suburbia. That is a choice. So when Americans say something like, US cities are too big and spread out to do whatever, then yes, that's true. But that is literally the problem that urbanists are trying to solve. So it's not really helpful to restate the problem and then use that as the excuse as to why it can't be solved. Though I admit, actually fixing American and Canadian cities after they were destroyed by car infrastructure and then rebuilt to be car dependent is a very daunting task, and I'm personally not even convinced it can be done in the foreseeable future, which is a big part of the reason why we left North America for a better city in the Netherlands in the first place. Because ultimately, the Dutch make great places while North Americans make excuses. But there's no excuse for watching ads and sponsor messages on YouTube when you could be watching this video on Nebula. But seriously, Nebula is a fantastic streaming platform, and many of the creators you already watch are already on there, like Wendover Productions and Real Life Lore, as well as other urbanist channels like City Beautiful, RM Transit, and City Nerd. All content on Nebula is ad-free and sponsor-free, so my Nebula viewers don't see sponsor messages like this one. You'll also get access to Nebula Originals, content that's only available on Nebula. I can personally recommend the City Beautiful series Great Cities, about the history of some of the greatest cities in the world. There's also Nebula Classes, full-length classes from your favorite Nebula creators, now included with any subscription to Nebula. If you sign up using the link go.nebula.tv/notjustbikes, you'll get 40% off an annual plan, which gives you all of Nebula for as little as $30 per year, which is a pretty great deal for such a good streaming service. By signing up with this link, you'll also be supporting this channel as well as any creators you watch on Nebula. Thanks to Nebula for sponsoring this video. I'd also like to thank my supporters on Nebula and Patreon who don't pay me to make excuses. If you'd like to support the channel, visit nebula.tv/notjustbikes or patreon.com/notjustbikes.